God be with you all, and welcome to this celebration of the third Sunday of Lent. And this morning, following the order of service for Choral Matins, or morning prayer, from our Book of Common Prayer, of course, it's all printed out in your bulletin. A couple of things that are not in the bulletin. The first is that we needed a time to bring the offering forward, so as the choir is finishing their anthem, we're going to do the offertory just before we go on to the prayers. And also, it's been our custom when we say or sing a morning prayer or choral matins that we that the officiant sings the collects and we sing the amens. And so it says in the bulletin, well, it's the collect for the day is printed in bold type. Normally that's code for we all say it together, but hold off for the amens for those collects, and the choir will help us sing those amens. And welcome to those who are visiting with us and worshiping with us online on our YouTube channel. And we welcome all who are returning home or who are visiting with us or who are new to St. James. God be with you all. Our scripture sentence for the season of Lent. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Rend your heart and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Dearly beloved brothers and sisters, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and a humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace. I invite you to kneel or be seated. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all they that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore we beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips.
And our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, hear
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise ye the Lord. Sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and show ourselves glad in him with songs. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, oh, that ye would hear his voice. Harden not your hearts as in the provocation, and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works. 40 years long was I grieved with that generation, and said, it is a people that do err in their hearts, for they have not known my ways. Unto whom I swear in my wrath that they should not enter into my rest. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that I may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and a commander for the peoples. See, you shall call the nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples for us, so that we may not desire evil as they did. Do not become idolaters, as some of them did. As it is written, the poor sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did. And 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. And do not complain, as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. These things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us, on whom the ends of the ages have come. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. And God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is written in the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, beginning at the first verse. At that very time, there were some present who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that these Galileans suffered in this way because they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I've come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year, until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down. The Gospel of Christ. Lord Jesus Christ.
Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people,
and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hands of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our forefathers, and to remember his holy covenant, to perform the oath which he swore to our forefather Abraham, that he would grant us, that we being delivered out of the hands of our enemies might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And the child shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people for the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Loving God, grant each of us a word from your word, in your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. I don't know if you're finding this at this stage of your life as I do, but it's getting harder and harder for me to remember my early childhood. Is this happening to you? But you can take some cues about how you were as a young child from your grandchildren or your children, and they might, those memories actually might prompt you to recall a time when we were children and we thought our parents knew everything. We might not remember that ourselves, but we could see that in our children. I remember those wonderful, short-lived days when my boys thought I could explain anything to them, from how a lift lock works to why people do those things that they do. And it was, as I say, kind of short-lived. We were in, I remember times with Samuel being inside a Tim Hortons, and he would start his morning 20 questions while we were standing in the lineup for the cashier. And you could tell that because other people didn't have anything to do, that every ear in the line was listening, both to the questions and to what the answerer would say. And it wasn't too long before that just stopped. Didn't last very long. Our children became early adolescents and then teens, and there was this magical, swift flip that occurred, and suddenly they knew everything and we knew nothing. Remember that? I don't know what happens to parents' knowledge. Maybe it's something genetic, a flaw, you know, in us. So for a mother and a father, every time the child that they've brought into the world turns about 13, their parents lose all the knowledge and experience they ever had for the last 30 or 40 years. I don't know how that works, but maybe a neurologist could tell me how that happens. When I'm interviewing parents who are preparing their children's for their children's baptisms, I tell them that the purpose of godparents has very little to do with making sure there's someone there for your kids in case something should happen to you. That's why, by the way, we write wills and put people in as legal guardians. That's what it's for. No, the rest reason for having trusted and believing godparents who establish a relationship with our children is because of that moment when our kids stop hearing everything we say. And they need somebody normal, that is not a parent, to whom they can take their questions. That's what godparents are really good for. Now, to be fair, as adults, we also have misconceptions about things we think we know. We size up politicians by a few things they say or do, and that's it. Or maybe by the people they associate with. And we do this with other people as well. So it can be very hard to see anything more or different from a person, including their ability to change, once we've decided what we think about them. To buck this tendency, rather inspiringly, for the last couple of weeks, Garrett has been raising the question among us, and it goes something like this. What can we do as Christians at St. James to reach out to those who are not like us, like the truckers involved in the protests, or the anti-vaxxers, or really anyone from a group from which we have dissociated ourselves? It's the right question. It's a necessary question because of the way we often think. Most of us have people about whom we've formed pretty strong thoughts or opinions. Now, in Jesus' day, one of the very common thoughts many people had was that if something bad happened to someone else, well, they must have done something to deserve it. Even Jesus' first followers, to whom we now look up to and call saints, once looked at a man born blind and said to Jesus, "Who sinned, Lord, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" It must have been somebody. Jesus had to say, "Neither one. But it is the occasion for you to see the glory of God in his healing." Even today, if we were to write off every single person living in Russia, they share with us this very human expectation and this way of thinking. They're just like us. And this enables Mr. Putin to tell Russians, "We have sent our army into Ukraine because they were a threat to us. They are Nazis, or they are corrupted by Western military interests. And because of our desire to peg other people, that actually works for a lot of folks." And at least for a while, Russians might be duped into saying, "Oh, well, if they needed to be stopped or corrected or punished," because they share with us this way of thinking, still around. Something like that same way of thinking was going on when in our gospel, people told Jesus about Galileans who were brutally murdered by Pilate while they were at church. That's what it means to mingle their blood with their sacrifices. They were worshiping when they were butchered. And the unspoken thought is right there. "What do you think about that, Lord? What must they have done for this to have happened to them and not to us or to any of the other people around? But Jesus doesn't fall into that limited way of thinking about people, about suffering, or about sin. Instead, he says, we are all the same. Bad things can and indeed will happen to us too. And it's not that other people may be worse or even better than any of us. All of us do and say things, and we have done in our lives before this moment, that hurt our relationships with others, that break relationships, or hurt our relationship with God, or make us less than we were meant to be, and that's called sin. But when we get reminders about how fragile life is, well, then we know we have some work to do, because time is short. And so Jesus is offering to help us replace our way of thinking and seeing the world with God's way. That's what Isaiah was talking about as well. He's calling us to get busy, to get ready, to get active, and to access the help that God is always wanting to provide us. And our Lord does it at first in the most shocking of language. Jesus, from time to time, likes to shock us into seeing something we haven't been seeing. So he adds to the story that's brought to him about those Galileans another one, a violent story of his own. It's no different, he says, than those 18 who were killed by that Tower of Siloam that fell on them in Jerusalem. Do you think they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No. But I tell you, unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. And that was meant to shock them, and it's meant to shock us. It should shock us. Now, by the way, we have a tower here at St. James, quite a big one. And yet I don't believe that Jesus is saying to us we should expect that it will soon be falling on our heads because we haven't confessed our sins. We haven't repented. Also, we're not in Ukraine right now, but people lining up for bread, or who could be just as easily on their way to church or in church like we are today, are right now vulnerable, we know, to being killed by an invading army. And that is not much different than Pilate killing Galilean worshipers, as Jesus had just been told. But Jesus would not say that unless Ukrainians or unless you and I smarten up, we're going to suffer like those people under the Tower of Siloam. He's saying life is fragile. And the people who died, just as Jesus had heard, or the people dying, as you and I hear way too much every day, are not worse or more deserving of harm or suffering than anyone else is. Life is fragile, Jesus says. Things can change in an instant, and boy, we know that. We know that 2 years ago this month, that things can change in an instant, or as they did for my cousin, who was driving on a highway on his day off in the United Arab Emirates, where he was doing some contract work, and ended up in a coma and died just last week. Life is fragile. So Jesus says there is an urgency in this call for repentance, or for our changing the way we think and act. Repentance, what he's asking us to do, is not about, by the way, it's not about beating our chests or being made to feel miserable or worse, as some of us fall into this trap of hating ourselves. No, it's about an intentional and motivated desire to turn around and to begin to see ourselves and the world from a different point of view, from God's point of view. And of course, when we do that, a life-giving change of perspective, a letting go, as some of us need to do, a letting go of some things, and then a being open to more fruitful gifts from God will come with a change in our actions as well. God and we will know how much we've turned by our change in action. Now, it helps to remember, I think, that when Jesus said all of this to us, he was on his way to Jerusalem. He was healing and he was teaching as he traveled. And in the chapters leading up to our gospel for today, St. Luke has been telling us that for a while now, our Lord was trying to help those who would follow him to recognize what Jesus called the signs of the times. You're good at seeing the signs of the times with things like crops and March 20th, 21st, and so on, but you're missing the more important signs of the times. And he's been using these evocative images and stories, like the one about the guy who was doing rather well, and he figured he should just build more barns to store all his extra stuff in, but soon he's not going to need any barns. Or that one about the birds of the air, to help us see why we don't need to worry about having enough. And then there was the one about what servants get up to while their master is away, little thinking that he will come home at any minute and see what they're up to. So today, he responds to horrific stories about what befell some people and not others, and then he talks about an unfruitful fig tree. Talk about changing gears or mixing metaphors. But there is a common thread. I was reminded this week that fig trees in the Middle East are incredibly fruitful. With all the sunlight and two rainy seasons that they have, they can produce as many as three crops a year. And they almost thrive on neglect, actually. But that means that in the little object lesson Jesus shares with us, that one particular tree had missed 9 opportunities to bear fruit in the last 3 years. So as the story goes, the owner, coming after the 3rd year, wants to cut it down and cut his losses and stop wasting good land on a fruitless tree. Time is up, he says. But the gardener pleads with him to give us, or rather to give the tree, one more chance, one more year of careful nurture. So this story, which comes at the end of calls for the urgency of repentance, is actually a story about us being cared for and advocated for. And it's about us being given just a little bit more time, rather than being judged or written off this minute. It's about us being given another chance, another opportunity to be fruitful, to walk in the way of the Lord, and to start seeing others and ourselves as God sees us, as redeemable, lovable children, and, to change the metaphor, fruitful trees. And this word comes from the lips of our caregiver, who we might put Jesus in that place as being the gardener, who advocates that we should be given just a little bit more time. So bad things are going to keep happening in our broken world. They just will. And they're going to happen to us as believers, and maybe sometimes because we are believers, as St. Paul says. And we're going to be given opportunities to help those who are affected or harmed by those bad things. And if the bad thing happens to be happening to us, as St. Paul says, God will provide a way so that we can stand up under it, or endure it, as our translation says. But we have other urgent work to do. And what better time to do it than this Lenten season? It's tailor-made for this reading. To change our ways, or our minds and our hearts, to stop going down paths of death and destruction, to stop writing others off or being written off ourselves, and to start heading towards life and restoration and fruitfulness. Rather than being fruitless trees, we can start to see things the way God sees them, and to take an active role in our own redemption here and now. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, Peter, I've just noticed that there are pieces in the prayer book that are not in the bulletin. So after the creed, I don't get to sing, "The Lord be with you and also with you, and the Lord have mercy and the Christ have mercy."
We can do that.
Shall we do that? Will you remember that? Would you stand with me, please, while we confess our faith? We say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and it sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us. O Lord, save the Queen. Endue thy ministers with righteousness.
And make thy chosen people joyful.
O Lord, save thy people.
And bless thy inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord.
And evermore rightly defend us.
O God, make clean our hearts within us. Father of mercy, alone we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. When we are discouraged by our weakness, strengthen us to follow Christ, our pattern and our hope, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom. Defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O Lord, our heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by thy governance, to do always that is righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We offer our gifts of praise and
prayer and ourselves. Blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, forever and ever. All that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. All things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen.
The response for our prayers is Amen. Let us pray for our Queen. O Lord God Almighty, who rulest the nations of the earth, we humbly beseech thee with thy favor to behold our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth, that in all things she may be led by thy guidance and protected by thy power. We pray thee also to bless the whole royal family. And do with wisdom the Governor General of this Dominion, the Lieutenant Governors of the provinces, the legislatures of the Commonwealth and Empire, our Prime Minister, and all who are set in authority, that all things may be so ordered and settled by their endeavors upon the best and surest foundations, that peace and happiness, truth and justice, religion and piety may be established among us for all generations. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us pray for our clergy and people. Almighty and everlasting God, from whom cometh every good and perfect gift, send down upon our bishops and clergy and all congregations committed to their charge the healthful spirit of thy grace, that they may truly please thee, pour upon them the continual dew of thy blessing. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ. Amen. O God, the creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of men, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving help unto all nations. More especially, we pray for the good estate of the Catholic Church, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who call and profess themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth, and hold the faith in the unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any way afflicted in or distressed in mind, body, or estate. We pray especially for Brian, Peyton, Eleanor, Sadie, Scott, Mid, Christiane, Phelan, Ron, Ed, Dorothy, Ruth, Jim, Dorothy, Cheryl, Ruth, Shane, Ted, Linda, Karen, Lisa, Robin, Janet, John and Hillary, Peggy, Robert, Mary, Jeff, Junie, Bet, Adam, the Reverend Bill Simons, and all of those we hold privately in our own hearts today. We beseech thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their suffering and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. We pray for those who have died recently, especially those we have lost during the pandemic, for those who have died in Ukraine, for the Russian soldiers also.
And this we beg for Jesus Christ, his sake. Amen. Amen. Almighty God and merciful Father, who wouldst have the kingdoms of the world become the kingdom of thy Son, Jesus Christ, bestow thy blessing, we beseech thee, upon all who labor for peace and righteousness among the peoples. Especially now we pray for the country of Ukraine, that the day may be hastened when war shall be no more, and thy will only shall govern the nations upon the earth. Kindle, we pray thee, in the hearts of all men and women, the true love of peace, and guide with thy pure and peaceable wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth. We pray especially today for the leadership of Russia, Ukraine, members of NATO, and all the nearby countries of Europe, that in tranquility thy kingdom may go forward till the earth is filled with the knowledge of thy love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and heartfelt thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men and women. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, for thine inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us all that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests, fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. Amen. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all forevermore. Amen.
Thank you to Leanna and to our choir for wonderful offerings to God today. I do commend your prayerful reading in the of the notices in the bulletin. Of course, if you get email from what Brenda sends out on Fridays, later this afternoon, are you not hearing me? No. I'm on. I'll go up here. So,
there is a note from me about the pew ribbons, and we've been talking a lot about how not to put people on the spot. So here's a couple of things. First of all, tomorrow apparently mask mandates end in Ontario, for good or for ill, and we have not been given that mandate for worship from our bishop. so we're not saying that yet. But when we do, and there will come a time when we do, make that optional, like the arrows on the floors and the doors you go out of and so on, people might still want to wear a mask. And they might want to wear a mask because they want to protect you, because they think they might be coming down with a cold. They might wear a mask because they're still a little bit anxious, although most of our masks are designed to protect other people, not ourselves. But we need to respect that. I'm going to wear masks from time to time. I'm certainly going to be wearing them this week when I go into a store and other things, regardless of the mandate. And that's going to stay with us for a long time, maybe forever. And it's got to be okay. It's got to be absolutely okay. With the removal of the ribbons from the pews, some of you may just now, and I can't quite tell, but may have looked for your old pew. And now that there's not a ribbon barring you from that space, you've gone right back there. The only flaw in that is that it doesn't give you any social distance because somebody else might be sitting there already or right next door. So as not to put people on the spot, we're asking that you don't sit beside someone else less than 6 feet away unless you've prearranged with them to do so. Either you came with them and they're members of your household, and that's perfectly okay, or maybe you drove together, or maybe you just always sit together and you're both comfortable with that. Unless that's the case, I don't want people being put on the spot by saying, you don't mind if I sit here, do you? Because that's not fair. It puts all the onus on the other person, and we want to make people feel comfortable. And we're a little bit anxious about the fact that with the lowering of mandates, some people may feel less comfortable in church than they do even today, and we want to curtail that as much as possible by being careful and respectful. So I commend that all to you, and some of that speaks about right now, and some of that's about the days coming up. Now, there is a thank you, as we said verbally, but there's a written one now for the wonderful folks who helped with the community dinner last Saturday, a week ago Saturday, and we're very grateful for all of those things. And I want to say again how grateful we are to the Table Community Food Center for letting us use their facilities once a month to do our community dinner. And that's probably going to go on until June. We heard this week that maybe in May the restoration will be done in our kitchens and hall and so on. And now I'd like to invite Lane to come forward. You got to use this mic, I'm afraid, Lane, to tell us about Muffin Mania next Saturday.
As you've heard for several weeks, this is a new initiative of the Guild, and I just want to thank all of the wonderful bakers that I've talked to. They've all been very good, and as of now, I think we have about 24 different types of muffins that are on offer, and people have been very good. They said, oh, this is a family favorite, or it's a special recipe. Or it's a special treat, and so far we haven't had any overlaps on any of the muffins. The reason we're asking you to order early is to make sure that you get a chance to try all of these different types, and you might find out you have some favorite ones coming. So it's this Saturday, and it's from 1 to 3 for pickup. And we just want to make sure we have enough, so if you order, if you think anyone, any of your friends would be interested, we're glad to take lots of orders. And it could be a treat for Mothering Sunday, which comes the day after. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Elaine, where will we come to pick things
up? The front door of the church. Because for insurance, we're not to be downstairs, so it'll be drive-through at the front. So that makes it more convenient.
Excellent.
Thank you. That's wonderful.
As you know, our guild has been very creative in trying to continue to promote activities and also raise much-needed funds for the parish, even with all the restrictions during COVID. And this is a brand new one and wonderful to hear about. So I hope you'll support it. We have our Bible study on Wednesdays continuing this week, 7 o'clock in the Anna Wilson Room. We sit amidst old cupboards and gear taken out of the kitchen, but we get by. And you're welcome to join us this week. You don't have to have come from a previous week. And we're studying the letter to the Philippians and beginning chapter 2 this week. So I commend that to you. And I also commend to you, of course, the letter that went out from the wardens. For those of you who have email, you already have that letter. And it's a very urgent and important one to read about the life of our parish family. And if you haven't received it by email, because you don't receive email from the church, one will be coming to you in the mail in the next few days. So do look for that. And if you don't receive it either way, call the parish and we'll find a way to get you one of those letters from the wardens. Any other announcements? Am I missing something? No? Good. Well, we're going to praise God with our recessional hymn. Nice to say that. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah.